हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू GYS। हाउ आर यू? आई होप यू आर डूइंग वेल। सो फ्रेंड्स, एज यू नो दैट ऑन आवर चैनल वी आर कवरिंग द सिलेबस ऑफ यूपीएससी सिविल सर्विसेज, एंड फॉर दैट पर्पस वी हैव स्टार्टेड मल्टीपल सीरीज ऑन आवर चैनल दैट टारगेट योर प्रीलिम्स एज वेल एज मेंस। सो फ्रेंड्स, वी हैव ऑल्सो स्टार्टेड अ सीरीज इन विच व्हाट वी डू, वी डेली एनालाइज द एडिटोरियल्स ऑफ द न्यूज़पेपर इंडियन एक्सप्रेस। सो फ्रेंड्स, एज यू नो दैट देर आर लॉट ऑफ प्लेटफॉर्म्स दैट प्रोवाइड द एनालिसिस ऑफ द हिंदू, but there are very few channels that do the analysis of Indian Express. So we have taken this initiative for the purpose of helping you people in analyzing the important articles that are important for you people from your exam point of view, or in general that are of interest for you people. So friends, today is 20 April. So let's see what are the editorials of today. So here the first editorial, that is the restive kapu. So this article is not important because I have read it. It is not of your concern, so you can leave it this article. So the first article that we will be covering is a bad deal that is shown here on the left part of the screen. So let me zoom in this. So friends, this article is in the context of recent ban by our central government, and the ban that has been imposed in the bilateral trade between India and Pakistan. So recently the bilateral trade in Kashmir was halted by the Indian government citing various reasons. So this article is about this halting of the bilateral trade. So friends, let me tell you that this bilateral trade, I will not go by line by line to this editorial. I will simply give you the essence of the editorial, because ultimately it depends upon your reading that how do you, because it is ultimately your reading that will help you. I will only help you in getting an idea of the essence of the topic, of the article. So in this article the author says that the bilateral trade began in October 2008. So this bilateral trade began just 1 month before your Mumbai terror attacks that were there on Taj Hotel and on other multiple places in Mumbai. So even after that even at that time the bilateral trade continued irrespective of the deep freeze that was there in the India-Pakistan relations following the Mumbai terror attacks. So the trade did not ended, and its value increased from rupees 1 crore to rupees 3000 crore at present. But now the government has decided to halt this trade by citing the reasons like misuse of the route to push drugs into India, to push weapons into India, illegal weapons into India, and also the counterfeit currency into the valley, as well as to trade goods that are not listed in the list that is prepared for the bilateral trade. So this has been the concern of the Indian government. So certainly there is also a genuine concern that there is a supply of drugs, as well as due to this money goes towards the other side, Pakistan, and it is routed into India via terrorism. So terrorism is sponsored in India in this way. So also counterfeit currency problem is there. And friends, let me tell you that author says that this decision of the government is not wise. Let me tell you friends, this is not my opinion but the opinion of the author. So the author says that that this trade played a very much important role in India Pakistan, and especially it was of relevance for the Kashmiris that live across the line of control. So it was a kind of it was of symbolic importance for the Kashmiris. So though the trade growed from ₹1 crore to worth ₹3000 crore at present time, but there were also certain limitations also. For example, the trade was not operating at its full potential. The potential was very low, and also there was a huge red tapism due to the concerns of the both the governments, that is India and Pakistan, and also there was no availability of banking facilities. So the absence of the banking facilities shows that there is a problem of there is a kind of encouragement of hawala transactions, because if you are not getting the money through the banking channels, then certainly you will do your hawala transactions, and this hawala transactions add to black money as well as promote other problems also. So there was also another problem, that is the trade was being conducted through a barter system. So barter system was there, so there were many limitations in this way, and also there were no telephone connections across across the border for this purpose. So it was conducted through a barter system. So these were the broad limitations. But the author says this was of particularly important symbolic importance to the Kashmiris that lived on the both sides of the line of control. So in this context, the author wants to say that this trade is. Was a kind of confidence building measure between India and Pakistan, and especially in Kashmir. So the author substantiates his case by saying that after all, no trade route is in India is free from misuse. So there are various types of hawala transactions that are still going on in India, and the money is channeled from abroad into India by these hawala transactions. So in this context, if the government, the author says, okay, if the government had the apprehensions that it generally has, for example, the misuse of this channel to push drugs, and misuse to push drugs, weapons, counterfeit currency into the valley across the border, as well as trade in goods excluded from the list meant for the cross LOC trade, then the wise option would have been to monitor the crossing points at Uri and Chakanda Bagh, so through which this trade was taking place four times a week. So the author says the remedy was there by close monitoring of the trade, but the complete kind of, we can say, halting of the trade is not in India's interest, and it will further widen the gulf between India and Pakistan, because this was the only channel through which India and Pakistan were exchanging their exchanging the views. So now, by calling off this entire trade route because it is being misused, shows that a government has either lose control over the lose monitoring control over the trade, or either it is not willing to continue the dialogue process. But ultimately, author says it is very much important that the dialogue must have take place, and this could be the dialogue can only take place in the environment of confidence. So confidence building measures are necessary. So in this context, the author says it would be wise to resume the trade. So this is the view of the author, not mine, so don't consider it that it is my view. So next article, friends, that we are going to discuss is here the useful tedium of talking. So this is also the article relating to your India and Pakistan, and we will discuss this article, that is capital gains, after discussing this article that has been written by Khaled Ahmed. So it is he is a Pakistan based journalist. So he talked in this article about the possible ways in which India and Pakistan can initiate the dialogue process. So here the author talks about the older older tha that is there in the India-Pakistan relations, and also mentions the issues that remain continuously a thorn between the India and Pakistan. For example, the Kashmir issue, the cross-border terrorism. So both countries are focused on their priorities. India wants to talk only once the Pakistan stops cross-border terrorism. But Pakistan wants that it wants to talk about first the Kashmir and then about the rest of the issues. So for this has continued for years. But now the author wants to say with the coming of the new prime minister in Pakistan, that is Imran Khan, he wanted to normalize, sort of normalization of relationship with India before front loading Kashmir. So in this context, the initiatives like Kartarpur corridor facilitating six, and there was another there is kind of another free we can say here the Pakistan offered Kartarpur corridor, as well as the facilitation of Hindu visitors to the Sharda Peeth Shrine, which is also in Pakistan. So the author wants to say that the Pakistan government wanted to resume the dialogue process. So in this context, the Prime Minister of Pakistan, Imran Khan, was very much interested, and the Army Chief General Bajwa was also of this view, but this could not take place because there must many thorns again in between India and Pakistan. So here in this context, the author says that the earlier Prime Minister of India Manmohan Singh also tried to normalize the relations through initiatives like the connectivity concept developed under SAARC. So under this, the Prime Minister Manmohan Singh applied his mind to end the Indo-Pak dialogue. So he saw the normalization of relations in free travel, free trade, and free road access and through each other's territory, apart from gas pipelines to India from Iran and Turkmenistan through Pakistan, thus getting rid of revisionist agendas that trigger war and terrorism through non-state actors. So friends, here the important point that is to be noted is the revisionist agenda. So what is revisionist agenda? So it is an agenda that is followed by Pakistan. So due to the repeated defeats of the Pakistan in Indo-Pak wars, especially in the Indo-Pak war of 1971, the Pakistan wants to repeat the process and wants to inflict a kind of commensurate damage to India, so as to kind of, we can say, to gratify its desire for revenge. So this is the author says that this is the revisionist agenda which has been keeping Pakistan in a totally deplorable condition and its economy in a deplorable condition. So here the author takes the example of India. So he says that if India fought a war with China in 1962, but India did not follow a revisionist agenda, rather it chose trade instead, and now it is a high growth economy in Asia and in third world states. So also he gives the example of Bangladesh, which itself broke away from Pakistan in 1971, and now its growth rate is higher than Pakistan, which the author says it is a point of shame for Pakistan, because the country that formed after it is now growing at a faster pace than the Pakistan. So in this context, the author says Prime Minister Imran Khan tried his best, and he must try his best, and the other things that he mentioned here is that that unless and until Pakistan renounces its revisionist agenda, that is to get revenge of the past events, unless and until this does not stop, the normalization will not happen. So in this context, author also highlights that in this context, the ruling party or the ruling government in India should also take note of this. And in this context, author says if the Prime Minister Narendra Modi returned after the elections, he must start the dialogue process with Pakistan, because Pakistan also wants to self-correct itself, and if it would be wise to help Pakistan in the self course correction, which is very much needed so that the confidence building measures could be enhanced and the bilateral issues can be resolved and the kind of freeze in relations could be ended. So this is all about this article. And next article that we are going to discuss is this article, that is capital gains. So this is the article related to economy. So friends, the Indian tax, you know that in this changing world, changes happen very fast. So sometimes they are so fast that they are not perceptible. So in this context, the author writes the new tax regime that is to be evolved is the need of the day, because here the author gives the example of this digital world, in which digital firms and multinational companies, they operate from different zones and different they operate in different boundaries, and they sometimes resort to unscrupulous activities to avoid tax, and they exploit loopholes to transfer their profits to low tax destinations. So in this context, author says India's tax authorities is now considering a revamp of the rules of taxing multinational companies as well as digital firms. So the main purpose, the author says, is to ensure the taxation rights on income generated by the global firms operating across various jurisdictions. So the purpose is to safeguard the interest of the revenue sector of the country. So rise in the digital and gig economy has particularly made the concept of physical presence as a kind of redundant concept, because there are a lot of companies that are operating from America, or for that matter other developed countries, but they don't have any physical presence in other country. So in that context, tax, they are getting the profit from the consumer country, but they are not based in it. And if they are not based in it, then they are avoiding the tax, because the now the prevalent tax regime requires the physical presence of a firm in the territory to in order to tax it. In this context, the author says in this way there is a lot of revenue loss to the countries which don't have the physical presence of these MNCs, but these MNCs get profit out of these countries. So in this context, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development recognizes this situation and it envisages a global consensus on tax rules by 2020. So it has been forcing multiple governments to bring fundamental changes to the taxation, so that it ensures that the tax revenues to ensure the tax revenues are not eroded. So Indian authorities are also they are also considering this such scenarios. So because India is a developing country and revenue is the main source of income for the economy, and government cannot compromise on revenue. So in this context, now the Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development has proposed a model tax convention which favors granting taxation rights to the country of residence of taxpayers. So here the problem is that the model tax convention that is proposed by this OECD has a problem that it favors the country in which the MNC is based. So in this context, India and some other countries do not agree with it, because they argue that this taxation, this is a kind of violation of their taxation rights, and taxation rights should be allowed in the jurisdiction where value is created, and not just the physical presence, but where the value is created, that must be considered. So in this context, the Indian tax authorities are considering the change. So here the author says that Indian authorities have argued rightly that a model will not mean just losing revenue, but also taxing local entities, for example local firms, which will harm them and will push them into a non-competitive environment due to the tax by the local government. So in this context, it would be right to ensure that taxation rights are not violated. And also in this context, author ends with a cautious note that it is necessary to tax the profitable income, but the government must keep in mind that this taxation right should not go to the extent that it discourages the foreign direct investment in India. So the author says that the new formula or rules must be framed in a manner that they must be transparent, and they must be certain, and they must be predictable, so that the foreign investors do not have to worry about the following consequences of a newly introduced tax regime, for example litigation and other things. So author says that basically the foreign investors want predictability and transparency as well as stability. So this must be ensured while safeguarding the taxation rights of the country. So this is all about this article, and let's move on to the next article. Next article is very important here. This next article is half MPs, half votes. So here we will look at the first past the post system that is currently followed in India in the Lok Sabha and the Legislative Assembly. So this article is written by Nalini Singh. She is a senior journalist. So here we will not go into the political thing that the author talks about. So recently, a leader of a ruling party, MP of a ruling party, I will name that person, Menaka Gandhi, recently was seen threatening the local voters that if they don't voted for them, she will not be helping those people. So in this context, this article is there. So here the author is basically against first past the post system and argues multiple reasons for this, because the author says that the first past the post system is such that it leads to a large exclusion of people from representation. Here the author gives the example of data. So here the author says ki consider the recent data, that is that the parliament, the current parliament is elected only by just 45% of the actual voters. So in fact 543 seats are represented by the 45% voters, but whereas 55% of the actual voters who did not voted for those MPs, they are in kind of not represented because ultimately their MP was not elected to the parliament and they are not represented. So this, in this way, the author says that this is the first very first case of large scale exclusion. So there is, for example, if there 55% of the actual voters who did not voted for the winning candidate, then certainly they will not be represented in the parliament and their votes will be wasted. So it, the question comes then that who will represent them in the, for the next 5 years. So this is a kind of very first stage of exclusion that the first past the post system brings with it. So here in the context of this article, the author says it is not that it has happened during the current NDA government. So this has continued from 70 years of independence. So now actually, in fact, if we look at the data of the 2014 Lok Sabha elections, then in 2014 Lok Sabha elections, the BJP won an absolute majority of 282 seats. So but it had received only the 31% votes of total votes actually polled. So in this context, if the author says ki if we combine the votes of its partners, its allies, then the total vote share of National Democratic Alliance, that is NDA, is 38.5% of the actual votes. So in this manner, the over two-thirds of the population is not represented. So only one-third of the population is represented in true sense. And author here in this paragraph also says in fact the actual number of the individuals that are represented are very, very low, because why? They could have voted for a candidate and he might have made it to the parliament but he might not have voted for the party who is forming the government. So in this context, so this is the second stage of exclusion, that is he voted for someone else and the benefit is getting his vote in fact is not counted in this manner. So nearly 66% of the country's population in this manner does not approve the government that forms after the elections that adopt the first past the post system. So the author takes also the example of UPA government, where it says that UPA also was ruling, but it had just 37% of the actual vote share. So less than two-thirds of India's actual voters were not represented in government. So this has led to strong governments, but on the basis of a shrinking vote base. So this is a kind of grave issue which must be looked into, because the 66% of the people are not getting represented, or they are not represented by the persons they are willing they are willing to give the right to represent themselves. So in this context, also says in 2019 and 2024, crores of Indian voters will shuffle around as citizens of a lesser India. So this process will further continue, because ultimately the elections will take place on the basis of first past the post system. So here author also wants to highlight that each candidate can access the vote count in each booth. For example, if you are voting in near your booth in these general Lok Sabha elections, then certainly your MP will be knowing after elections that in your booth how many votes were polled in favor of him and how many votes were polled against him. So in this way, different booths or different areas can be categorized as pro candidate or against candidate. So in this way, this opens the possibility of hostility of the MP towards a particular area if he doesn't get much votes from that particular constituency, and it is against the constitutional mandate which prescribes the MPs to serve the nation without any fear of affection and without any kind of biasness. So here author also wants to also highlights the point that this system has been taken from the country that was very small, that was an island nation, that is England. So England adopted this system, but we followed them. In fact, we are the largest democracy in the world, but in case if there are if we have to 125 crore people in India, but two-third of the India's population is not represented in the government institutions. So this is basically the thing the author wants to say. So here the author suggests an alternative system, and many of you people might be knowing about it, and that alternative system is proportional representation. So basically, proportional representation is what? Proportional representation is a way of kind of representation in which the party gets as many seats in the Lok Sabha in proportion to its vote share. For example, if there are 100 votes polled, or take the example of the author that gives that if there are 10,000, I will give you a manual example. Suppose there are 100 votes that are polled. So if 40 votes are polled to and total there are 10 seats, and if 40 votes are polled to a particular party, then that party will get 4 seats in Lok Sabha. And similarly, if another party gets 30% vote share, then it will get 3 seats in Lok Sabha. So the seats are allotted in proportion to the vote share of the party. So this the author wants to say that this ensures the representation of all the people. So it also does not lead to kind of alienation of people from the process, because each vote counts. Because when you poll your vote, certainly it will be counted in the vote share of the party, and you will be representing you will be kind of satisfied by the party and its representation, because you will feel that your vote has been counted. Otherwise, in first past the post system, the votes are totally wasted in as per the author. So in this way also, the author wants to highlight ke if we can see the other benefits of this proportional representation, then this also deepens the meaning of democracy. Because ultimately, if people are getting the feeling that they have been their vote is counted, then certainly we can say there could be a high turnout in elections, because the people are bound to vote if they feel that their vote is counted. So if the system is so that their vote is not counted, then certainly they will not be voting, and voting turnout will be less. So here the author also wants to highlight that nearly 94 countries in the world are there who have abandoned or who have not followed this first past the post system just because of this loopholes, that is not the proportional representation. So here in proportional representation, they pre-announce their list of lawmakers, and the people will be knowing that if, for example, the party announces the name 543 names that will be in case the party gets 100% vote share, then these will be the 543 lawmakers that will represent it. So in that case, what the parties do, they will enlist their potential lawmakers in advance, and people will vote for the party instead of the candidate. So in this way, this will also help the small regional parties also who and other parties who have their vote share kind of quite dispersed. So for example, there are many parties that have their vote share widely dispersed. So but the delimitation of constituencies is such that their vote share becomes in minority in a particular constituency. So they are not able to win the elections even if they get the higher votes in the elections, because their vote share is distributed. So in this case, this harm of not getting elected is also done away with, because regional parties can also perform well whose vote share is quite dispersed. So here the other thing the author wants to highlight and I also want to add is that the most beneficial thing of such a system is that it kind of ensures that there is not narrow perspective and narrow approach to the politics. So what some parties do, they concentrate on the areas in which they have their major vote share, and they focus their attention on those areas. But in case the party has to in case the party wants to gain maximum seats, it must ensure that it gets maximum votes. So certainly it will broaden its approach, it will become cosmopolitan cosmopolitan in its approach, and it will try to appeal to the people who are not likely to vote for it, and but they might vote for it in case they are convinced. So this also encourages a wider perspective in the politics. So this is the plus point of this proportional representation. So in this way, the author wants to say this deepens the democracy, as arm voter sees himself or herself as empowered. So this is all about this lecture. So there is not much that is to be talked about here. So this is basically the first past the post system is criticized and proportional representation is favored. So you can read about it. And the next article is about the Sacher Committee report. So this article is written in the context of first death anniversary of Justice Rajendra Sacher, who was a chairman of a very important committee which provided insights into the condition, socio-economic and educational condition of Muslims in India. So here we will be not reading about the Justice Sacher, but we will be reading about its report. So I will not highlight any point here. I will just give you a broad idea that what recommendations did this report made, and what were its observations. So first observation was that there was economic inequality, social insecurity, and alienation of Muslims was quite higher as compared to other Indians. So there was a large possibility of economic inequality as well as social insecurity. And also it was seen that in proportion to their population, that was 138 million in 2001, the Muslims were underrepresented in civil services, military, and in politics. So the committee found that Muslims were more likely to be poor, illiterate, and unhealthy, and to have trouble with the law in comparison to other Indians. So the author wants to say that this expose the myth of Muslim appeasement, which some parties were saying that the government is doing the Muslim appeasement. So after that, author wants to say that the other thing that such a committee highlighted is that their needs have been ignored. So the report states that the minorities and especially Muslims have been the ignored factor in the central government. And also this report it recommended the establishment of Equal Opportunity Commission so as to prevent the discrimination against minorities in private sector matters, for example housing and employment. So in public sector obviously there are fundamental rights, but in private sector there is no body that can ensure the rights of the minorities. So there are a lot of cases in which minorities are discriminated against by the private sector entities in case of matters of housing and employment. So in this context, the committee recommended the establishment of Equal Opportunity Commission, which was to inquire into the complaints of discrimination in case it is done by the private sector, in which case the Supreme Court or the High Court cannot intervene in itself. So this recommendation was very important. And the other thing this report said that the implementation of this report, my report is that is such a committee found is that the implementation is very poor. And also the other thing the author wants to highlight here is that this Equal Opportunity Commission could be set up without taking permission from the center. So this was a very important recommendation, but this did not found enough attention, so was not implemented. Other thing the report highlighted was the unfairness of the divisions of the constituencies. So as I have discussed in the previous article, as the author in the previous article said that in the first past this post system, what happens? The candidate that is receiving the maximum vote share wins. But in case a candidate has dispersed if its vote share is kind of dispersed, then it is unlikely for that candidate to win. So that's why, due to first past the post system, this is the limitation of first past the post system. So in this context, the Sacher Committee said that this delimitation of the constituencies are such that Muslims are in minority in different constituencies and thus are not able to elect their their leaders. So the committee argued in favor of the kind of rational and viable distribution of and division of electoral constituencies. And also the author also highlighted that this such a committee also highlighted that that the this process of Muslim of Muslims equality must be addressed as soon as possible. So this is all about this lecture, and this is all about for today's analysis. And if you like this analysis, then you can like this video, and also ensure that you, if you like this video, then do ensure that you share it with your friends. And lastly, friends, do ensure that you subscribe to our channel. Do not forget to press the bell icon, because then only you will get all the important notifications about the updates that we do on our channel. So thank you, friends. Have a very nice day.